with an alabaster flask of anointment of pure nard, very costly, and she broke the flask and poured it over his head. There were some who said to themselves indignantly, "Why was the ointment wasted like that? For this ointment could have been sold for more than 300 denarii and given to the poor," and they scolded her. But Jesus said, "Leave her alone. Why do you trouble her? She has done a beautiful thing to me, for you always have the poor with you, and whenever you want, you can do good for them. But you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anointed my body beforehand for burial. And truly, I say to you, wherever the gospel is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in memory of her." This is the word of the Lord. Please be seated.
Well, good morning, and welcome to Ruston Presbyterian Church. You might not have recognized it on the way in this morning. If you're visiting us or have been away for the just between last week and the week before, the whole outside of the church was just redone. There's just a little portion in the back that needs to be finished because they sent a wrong color, but we are very excited. It looks, and it's wonderful and beautiful, but the Lord wants to make sure we remember our humble beginnings, even though about a booth outside, that when we arrived at church on Saturday to get ready, apparently the entire sound system area has been blown, and so we're actually, that's why you see cables, we're powering up from other parts of the church. That is why we have this beautiful presentation behind us. Hopefully we'll have it fixed this week, but we don't really even know what the problem is. So if I wanted to make a plug for the building, the new building campaign, here it is. This current facility needs lots of prayers. We'd like to build a new one just over there. Just a reminder that Sarah Marlin will be making a renewed call to the Nehemiah Challenge at the congregational meeting. So I do hope you're there for that. But this is a perfect picture of just a sample on the outside of how exciting it is to build and to what we want the church to be a beacon, to draw people in, but also how on the inside there's work that needs to be done. But as we're working through Leviticus 23, we're looking at feasts in Scripture. I want to remind people how important the Old Testament is to the New Testament. That Christ did almost everything he did and trying to help people see that he was the Messiah that was coming from the Jews. And so much he said, so much he taught, so much he did was so linked to particular places in the Old Testament that we being mostly Gentiles, mostly people removed from that time period, miss it. And so we wanted to do a small series on looking at these verses in Leviticus and seeing how Christ use them, preach them, or how the apostles pointed to Christ through them as we're looking at them. So I hope they will be a blessing to you as we're walking through it. Last week, we talked about the Sabbath. And my big picture for you is to think of the Sabbath almost like a handyman who comes and shows up to your house each week saying, we have some work we need to do. One thing I like about holy days and feasts is that, this might be a challenge to some of you, is that they actually start the night before the event. So the challenge should be that really, your preparation for worship here should really start in the morning, in the evening, last night. Imagine how much that would change our weekends and our schedules if there was that much preparation and thought and plans went into celebrating when we get together. And that's what these are in Leviticus. These are days and feasts that God is giving them. Like I said, he's giving them culture. He's saying this is how we want to celebrate as a people. And that's what we're looking at. And today we're looking at Passover, or more specifically, the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And what we'll see is that there are two that were kind of merged because they went back to back. They served each other. They were all telling the very same story. And what we're looking at in the passage in Mark is really a story that most of you have heard about, extravagant love. And I don't know if you have seen or experienced extravagant love. Depending on your personality type, it may make you gag, blah, or it may make you say, wow. There's a story of a guy named Jean Camille who was a count in France. And you can imagine the French are known for being lovers. And so he was known for every morning, every single morning, getting down on one knee and proposing to his wife every single day of his life. Apparently he proposed to her 23,000 times over the course of their long marriage. Think about that. Again, some of you go, whoa. Some of you are going, wow. Some of the wives are going, yes. But what we want to talk about again is how, what is the point of doing that? Why is extravagant love important? Why is it important to us? Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning, and we pray now that you would bless this time. Reveal your word to our hearts, Holy Spirit. We ask that we want to know you better, Lord Christ. So we ask that you would do that this morning. All this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. So we're not going to, the important thing to know about when the feast occurred is that, so Passover was the event when the final, actually Passover was the capstone event that when the people of God were in captivity, it was Passover that got them free. And so the Feast of Unleavened Bread is what they were doing in preparation at that time. So really, the way the feasts work together is that Passover was celebrated. The way they do it is the first, the night before, remember I said the events always happen the night before. The night before the first full moon of spring would be Passover. So they set their Passover, like when we follow that, to the lunar calendar. And so what happened was you'd have Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread would be a 7-day feast that would happen right at the end of Passover. And why this significant is to remind you that the unleavened bread was a piece of bread. We actually, if you've been a part of our Sabbath Passover Christian meals that we do here once a year, which are sold out every year, we do them at Randy's house. I hope you'll come. But this is it. This is what unleavened bread looks like. There's a big part of the event, the ceremony, and we'll talk about that in a second. But the Passover, as I was trying to, when we knew we had some problems here on Saturday, I didn't want to put any pictures up. But I wanted to say on July 14th, 1945, August 14th, sorry, 1945, was a very big day. I was going to put a picture up, and that was the famous picture of the sailor kissing the nurse in the middle of New York. And that was, what was that?
VJ.
VJ, yeah, that was the end of World War II. That was officially the war was over in Japan. Now the whole Passover celebration, Feast of Unleavened Bread, is kind of like a celebration to that order. But what we need to remember though, what Passover was about, was if I had put a picture of Hiroshima or Nagasaki up, what happened on Passover was scary and was defining. It was God letting the world know that he indeed controls life and death. He is in charge. And it was at the horror and shock of God showing his wrath that Egypt finally said, go. So their exodus was born out of God showing his wrath. So when they're celebrating the Passover, they're reminding themselves, not just that God loves us, but they're also reminding themselves that they serve a God who cares about righteousness and holiness. And they are to be a people proclaiming holiness and righteousness to the world around them. They are to be declaring how good it is to know God to the world around them. And so we find ourselves now in the passage of Mark, chapter 14, verse 1. It was now 2 days before the Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And the chief priests and the scribes were seeking how to arrest him by stealth and kill him. For they said, no, not during the feast, lest there be an uproar from the people. And so what we see again at this time, they estimate the normal population of Jerusalem was around 50,000, and around the time of Passover, it would multiply many times over, in the hundreds of thousands. And they said, people are here celebrating who God is and what he's done. And they're saying, us doing this right now would probably not be a great idea. Which is amazing is because it's basically when they do it. They decide to do it, then you see God's plans always trump human plans. You can keep reading the rest of the scripture and you'll see that this indeed, during this event, Christ coming in, it is all around this that the passion narrative, the story of Christ's crucifixion happens. They said, not now. And Christ says, God says, yes, it's going to be now. But before that, we see Jesus preparing for the Passover, preparing to celebrate the Feast of Unleavened Bread. This is, again, a part of his normal life. And what was the process? What was the bread supposed to remind us of? Well, it was two things. It had twofold purpose of reminding you what it was about. The first was, when you would go around the house, you would go around and you'd look for all different things that were used to maybe cook and had leaven in them, yeast. And because yeast was associated with sin. And so they would go around the house and they would try to collect all the dust particles they could to say, this is how much we are polluted with sin. It is everywhere. And we must search diligently and get it away from us. And so that was one half. And the other part, the reason why they were cooking with unleavened bread is because God told them, you must be ready. We don't have time for the bread to rise. For when you hear the sound, go. Go. Do not wait. So they were to have their meal at the ready. Staff in hand, cloaks tucked in, ready to go. And so the bread was a reminder both of God's holiness and his righteousness, his judgment, his power, his authority, the all, but also, amazingly enough, and also to them, a reminder of God's promise to never, ever forsake them, that he would come for them, claim them as his own, make them a people, take them to the promised land. It was really the institution, again, another beginning in a small way, a pointer to Jesus Christ who would come and finally bring salvation. That's why this meal was so important. Christ was teaching us from it, and that's where we're at right now. And while he was in Bethany, verse 3, and while he was in Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, as he was reclining at a table, a woman came with an alabaster flask of ointment of pure nard, very costly, and she broke the flask and poured it over his head. There were some who said to themselves indignantly, why was this ointment wasted like that? For this ointment could have been sold for more than 300 denarii and given to the poor. Now, in other Gospels, there's two accounts. There's one in Luke where there's a woman who anoints Jesus' feet and cleans his feet with her hair and her tears. This is a different woman. Maybe Mary heard about that particular event and she wanted to somehow emulate it. But this was Mary, according to John. Mary, who's the sister of Lazarus and Martha. And what's so significant about that is if you read the Gospel of John, one of my professors in seminary, who was definitely a John scholar, and other commentators would say, you know, when John was writing his Gospel, he knew about the Gospel of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and was writing his telling the same story, but wanted to kind of almost say, how did you forget about these stories when he was writing his? And for John, remember, all the Gospels are trying to tell you how Jesus is the Christ. And John's, his apex moment, aside from the resurrection, the crucifixion and the resurrection, for John, kind of the apex moment was the rising of Lazarus. Almost as if John was saying, how could all three of you guys forgotten to talk about Lazarus? A man who was dead for days. Body was already decaying. Sisters angry at Jesus for not saving him, and here he comes, and Mary was one of those people. And Jesus talks to her at the time when he raises Lazarus and Martha, and he's teaching everyone there, and he's asking, do you believe in the resurrection? And they go, yes. Well, on the last day, he goes, no, me, I am the resurrection. And he screams, Lazarus, come out, and Lazarus wakes up from the dead and comes out. It was that Mary. If any of you have ever lost a loved one, you can begin to probably appreciate what Mary felt when her brother was called back from the dead. this is that Mary. So you have one person in the room viewing Jesus a very specific way, and you have other people viewing Jesus in a different way. And that's what we see, that's kind of heads are kind of bumping. See, part of the gospel message is this, that Christ has come to redeem you, to pay for you, to do something to pay for your sins, to claim you as his own. And the problem with that, the problem where we mess up, where sin messes that up, where the sin, the leaven, that messes that up, is that it causes us to love the wrong things and to love things in the wrong kind of way. And the biggest way I can explain that is, I don't know, I've never had the privilege of doing this, maybe some of you have, but or you know someone who has. Does any of you own a boat or know someone who owns a boat? There's a funny, if you know anyone who does, and you ask them, what's it like owning a boat? They all tell you the same thing. It doesn't matter if they're a millionaire or they just got somehow got a little boat that they just kind of pull out on the lake. They all say, basically, if you want to know what it's like owning a boat, imagine a big hole on the top of the water you just keep throwing money into. That's what it's like owning a boat. It's constantly being fixed. I was riding with someone who we were going to go not jet skiing, we're going to go skiing or whatever in a boat, and he was like, oh, I got to fill it up first. I'm like, how many gallons is going in this boat? He's like, 200. I'm like, what? I'm thinking about how much it would cost to fill up just one outing for a boat ride. A big hole you just throw money into. Loving the wrong thing and loving it, think the wrong things in the wrong way is basically you're taking the pieces of your life, your heart, your soul, and loving the wrong thing is just you're just throwing what you have into a hole that will never ever fill and never ever give anything back. That's the problem of sin. It makes you love the wrong things and love things the wrong kind of way, right? Just like we're reading in our confession. There is a right way and a wrong way to love people and to love God. Just saying you love God isn't enough. It's how. And it causes us to love the wrong things. It causes us to love the wrong people. That's what sin does. And that's what the gospel has to come and address. We have a problem. And this love that we have towards the wrong things is leading us to our demise. So this Mary was, it says the just the facts are here, just, you know, she, the nard she poured out, 300 denarii, basically a year's worth of wages. She poured out a year's worth of wages on his head. And the response of some of the disciples, I think is the response I see from many of my friends who are skeptics and atheists, which is, for the disciples, they were like, okay, listen, we will adore Jesus, but there's a limit. There's a point where it gets ridiculous. Pouring out all that on his head, that was in the ridiculous side. There's a level. You gotta just keep it down, Mary, right? You know, just tone it down just a little bit. Well, my friends who are skeptics, my friends who are atheists, and if you have them, I'm assuming you do, you live in Northern Virginia, they almost look at any act of devotion or any act of anything important to Christ the same way the disciples view what Mary did. Just getting up to go to church seems like a waste of your morning, right? Just praying before your meal seems like a wasted opportunity. For some of you who claim to know Christ, just a little challenge mid-sermon, have you put a limit on the cost of how you can adore Christ and the way you love him? Because as you've already seen, Jesus has a response to her. So they're saying, what are you doing? Commentators love to point out that what Mary was doing, whether she understood it or not, probably didn't, but she was used in this. Jesus was being anointed by her, normally done by prophets and close family members, but she was adorning him for two things. For his coronation, which is usually done by a prophet, for his coronation as king. This was his moment. You would pour oil on their head, but also for burial. You're covered in spices. And Jesus is saying, this is what she's doing. She probably flew to the grass, but what she does know is that this is the guy who is the same God who at Passover freed our people up, and is the same God who can take life and he can give life. I think giving him what I have is okay. And Jesus' response, he's responding really to the disciples and the people who are aghast at what she's doing. Now, their comment, should this money be given to the poor? A very common thing to do during feasts was to give money to the poor. So what they were asking wasn't totally off base. But so Jesus is really, as you know, he's addressing what they said, but he's always really addressing their heart. And this is his response in verse 6. He says, but Jesus said, leave her alone. Why do you trouble her? She has done a beautiful thing to me. Last week, I talked about how the essence of this sermon is really about how ritual, the things we do to say we love Christ, void of a true faith, a true love of God, mean nothing to God. He doesn't want those. He doesn't have any time for those. And here, we see what it looks like when a ritual is mixed with a heart that's in the right place. Right? She's almost coming up with something kind of new. You're not supposed to go run around and do this to random people. But God says, this right here is beautiful. The most beautiful ritual done void of the heart, God says, I don't have time for that. It's almost offensive, is basically what he says. But a weird, awkward ritual performed by unworthy people, done with the right hearts and mind, Christ calls beautiful. He says, this is beautiful, what she is doing. And he goes on to say, for you will always have the poor with you, and wherever you want, you can do good for them, but you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anointed my body before my burial. And truly I say to you, whenever the gospel is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in memory of her. So what does Jesus say? I was thinking about how to explain this. So he talks about the poor, but what he's saying is, this is important to hear, ready? He's literally right there. So this isn't a sermon. If you ever heard someone say, this is a sermon why you should give your money to the church, you would say that's taking this out of context. Because what Jesus is literally saying is, no, I'm literally right here. So her loving on me is totally fine. If someone says, this is an example why you need to give all your money to the church, you would say, well, no. The church is Christ's representation here. Jesus was actually a person. And he's saying, I'm right here. Loving on me right now is totally appropriate. It's great. But he sets things in order. He says, listen, you need to care for the poor. You need to love on the poor. And they're going to be there. So if you're worried about loving on the poor, don't worry, they'll be here tomorrow, is basically what he's saying. But right now, I am here. And I was thinking about how, I remember one year, my dad decided, he was a creative type, and he decided it'd be fun to make this awkward Christmas display, which is just a big ball of lights wrapped in tinfoil. And it's exactly what it sounds like. And so, like what most dads do with their sons, which is what? Son, untangle that light. So my job was to take about 10 strands of lights that were in one box, all jumbled together, and my job was to untangle all of them. And the reason we did that is because we couldn't, if we tried to just take the jingle lights and just put them on, they wouldn't fit, they wouldn't do what they were trying to do. And what Christ here is really letting us know, especially in today's climate, especially in America, is that the secular world really wants to redirect and reorient how it is we express our faith in Christ. Love people, don't talk about Jesus. And what Christ here is saying is, get the order right, and there will be light for everything. Untangle the confusion, and we can spread it around. And he says, where you must start with is Christ. Loving the poor, serving the poor, does not trump serving Christ. It does not take the place of serving Christ, of loving on Christ. Only loving Christ is like loving Christ. But he says, but in loving him, there are other things you must do. So what is he doing here? He's giving us a great order. He's telling us the poor are important. The hurting, the widows, the orphans. These are people we should care about dramatically. But that should never become more important to us than loving Christ first. And as followers of Christ, your message must be that. The way you love your spouses, the way you love your children, the way you love your career, must reflect a submission to Christ being preeminent in all of that. Why? remember, everything else is a big hole you're just throwing into. But it's only Christ where that love comes back in an amazing way. And that's what he's trying to do for us, reorient how it is we're loving. Christ tells us love him first. He tells us we have to care about the poor. He tells us that right here. But he's doing that as a subtle rebuke to the disciples who were trying to forget about who Christ is right there. So the next mid-challenge of my sermon is this. Are your lights tangled up? Are you forgetting where you're supposed to start? If Christ is your first love, it will change the way you love your children. It'll change the way you love money. It'll change the way you love your job. If anything is mixed up with that, it has dire consequences for the way you love everything behind it. The bread, the unleavened bread, is supposed to be a reminder of that, of whom we are serving and where we are going. And then it ends, like I said, she was doing something special. She was proclaiming Christ. At the end of this passage, I can't think of any way. I mean, imagine, there have been praises Jesus has given to people. This might be probably the best praise Christ has given to anyone. Anyone, any disciples did not receive what I think Mary receives here. She humbles all of them. And truly I say to you, verse 9, wherever the gospel is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in memory of her. So does your gospel story include Mary? When you're telling people about Christ, does your story include the extravagant love of Christ and how our extravagant love from him never returns void? What Christ is saying about her is that her act here means, and you see, all gospel writers obeyed, that what she did here, what he basically said is the passion narrative, the story, we call that the story of Christ's crucifixion, everything, his resurrection. He's saying the passion narrative starts here. That whenever you tell this story, this is where we start with her. She must be included in this story. The gospel has come to correct our perspective, to help us see that we love the wrong things and we love the wrong things in the wrong way. What Christ is showing us through Mary here is that when we love him, it's not void, but we are filled. Christ came. God sent his son, and they sacrificed their most prized possessions. He sacrificed his son. He sacrificed himself. Out of an act of obedience, out of an act of love. Remember I said this bread represented God had to punish Egypt to free people? Well, God had to punish sin. He took on that punishment for us. That's what his love did for us. It freed us from sin, that we now love God. So for to those of you who don't know Christ or skeptics or know people who do, you need to help them see, you need to know that whatever it is you're loving will always return void. It is only loving Christ that you will see that your love of him can't even compare to the love he has for you. What his love brings you is holiness, righteousness, and eternal life. So does your gospel message that you preach to yourselves, and the gospel message you preach to others, does it include a beautiful, lavish love that Mary had for the Son? If it doesn't, then you're not telling the story right. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the feasts you created, Lord God. This feast points to how magnificent you are. and how your death and resurrection now changes the way we view this feast, and that you have now come. You have died for us, Lord God. You call yourself the bread of life. You were the bread of life. You are the bread of life, broken for us. You are the actual physical reminder of how beautiful the gospel message is. May we never forget that. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.